And good afternoon, good morning, and good evening to everyone on our second virtual annual general assembly, the first being last year. And we do hope that in next year, in 2022, we'll be able to meet in person for an annual general assembly, which is always more fun in person in terms of interaction and sharing of experiences and bringing together such a wide and diverse membership. Mr. Chair, the full annual report will be made available in the course of the week, hopefully tonight or tomorrow morning. So for the benefit of the audience, I will at this stage provide you with the headlines and main points covered in the annual general assembly, rather than reviewing the entirety of the annual report. As such, I'll try to keep my comments relatively short, but of course we remain available if there are any additional comments or questions in the course of the week from members, observers, and other stakeholders. Next slide, please. As a reminder, we are operating on the basis of the 2019 to 2023 strategic plan. As a result, our activities and our objectives are geared towards achieving the four goals which are laid out in the strategic plan. As a reminder, there are four key goals to which we operate. Goal one is to build the capacity of private security companies to implement the code and become certified members of ICoCA. Goal two is to build upon and continue to develop effective systems for evaluating compliance with the code of conduct and addressing non-compliance. Goal three is to diversify and expand ICoCA's membership among companies, governments, civil society, and ICoCA's engagement with other relevant stakeholders. And goal four is to develop and protect a distinct and credible worldwide brand reflecting ICoCA's leadership role. Those elements are covered in more detail in the full annual report. As I mentioned, I'll touch upon some of the key developments over the past 12 months for the sake of this particular presentation. Next slide, please. First comment, very much focusing on the issue of certification, which relates to goal one of the strategic plan. As we can see, this has been a very positive year in terms of certification numbers, with 23 security companies, including three affiliates, achieving ICoCA certification. Five security companies have obtained recertification. So that means that they have been certified, gone through the process, and have been recertified to the association standard as well as the industry standards. And today we have 47 security companies which are certified by ICoCA, which for the first time represents the largest grouping of corporate members and affiliate companies in the association. This demonstrates the growing added value and recognition of the importance of achieving ICoCA certification and of the gold standard that it offers to security companies wishing to ensure full compliance with the code. Next slide, please. This is simply illustrative of the range of companies, previous slide please, of the range of companies which have achieved ICoCA certification. For us, it is important to recognize what these companies have achieved, the level of transparency, as well as commitment that these companies have been showing to ensuring full compliance with the code and achieving certification. We also recognize the work of certification bodies working to the industry standards that we have so far recognized as part of the audit process and verification process of the security companies. We will naturally encourage all member companies to achieve certification, as well as affiliates to work towards certification. And our messaging as part of our outreach for clients and other stakeholders out there is the recognition of the standard that certification offers, and the assurances that an ICoCA certified member company offers as well as part of any human rights due diligence processes. This has been a positive year. Hopefully next year we'll see more developments in that regard. Next slide, please. The work of the association in relation to certification, of course, comes alongside our compliance efforts of working alongside our member companies to ensure that they are fully monitored to ensure full compliance to the code. So certification is one element of our core functions, monitoring in person, remote, as well as through the company self-assessment is an important second core function of the association. This year, as you can see from the graphs, the vast majority of our security company members have submitted their company self-assessment on time and completed their self-assessment. As part of the process, which is a mandatory requirement for our security providers, members as well as affiliates, the association offers tailored feedback to each and every single security company to ensure that they can address any lacunas, any question marks, or any areas for improvement within their own practices with regard to implementation of the code of conduct. Non-submission of the company self-assessment, as I mentioned, which is mandatory, will result in termination of that company from the association, be they members and or affiliates. This year, we have seen progress, again, as in previous years, in terms of the number of companies that have submitted the CSA, as well as a drop in terms of companies that have not submitted the CSAs. We'll continue to encourage our member companies to work with us in developing a strong company self-assessment as part of our monitoring efforts. In addition, this year, we added two sets of new indicators. The first linked to human rights impact assessments, which I'll touch upon a bit afterwards, linked to our work on development of a guidance. And secondly, on weapons and ammunition management, the WAM project, as we have called it, indicators which have been developed in collaboration with the Small Arms Survey and with the funding of the Swiss government. I would also like to recognize the work of a number of stakeholders, including observers and companies who are part of the process, as well as CSOs, in supporting the association and Small Arms Survey in developing these indicators and further deliverables, which will be coming out in the course of this year and next year. Thank you. Next slide, please. As the chair mentioned, we issued in 2019 our guidance on the prevention against sexual exploitation and abuse, guidelines which were developed to support, in particular, the UK government. This year, we issued our first online training for member companies and affiliates on the guidelines, PSCA, which can be both as a trainer-trainers course as well as directly used by security personnel. To date, over 1,000 individuals, over 63 countries, have taken the course since its launch. A number of companies, member companies, have made the taking of this course mandatory for the security personnel. The training is also being translated into French, Spanish, Arabic, and Chinese. As part of the capacity building and continual improvement, the work on this particularly important area of the code has been invaluable for the association over the past 12 months and its members. And despite the lockdown measures, the virtual nature of our work has not in any way lessened the impact of this online training and its access to members and affiliates. At this stage, the PSCA online training is available freely to all member and affiliate companies and their personnel. And we would encourage all of our companies to take the online training and to provide us feedback on any issue that they may see appropriate in terms of update and improvement or any other issues that they do come across. But again, to recognize the support of the UK FCDO in helping to develop both the guidelines as well as the training, and hopefully we'll take this to another stage next year. Thank you. Next slide, please. As mentioned by the chair and myself as part of the company self-assessment, to note also the important issuance of our guidance on human rights impact assessment, the first of its kind for private security providers. This guidance, again, developed with the support of the UK Foreign and Commonwealth Development Office, is a guidance for our member companies, which reflects and helps our member companies as part of a first step in their human rights due diligence and looking at the potential human rights impact of their operations and activities on local communities and other stakeholder groups. It's a hopefully very useful tool with an essay toolkit and takes our member companies and affiliates through a checklist to help them develop their own human rights impact assessment processes and to implement them fully. As mentioned also, the indicators linked to the human rights impact assessment processes have been incorporated into our company self-assessment and form part of this year's company self-assessment. We naturally welcome the feedback from member companies, affiliates, civil society organizations, governments, and any other stakeholders on the content of this particular guidance, on areas where you may wish to strengthen this, as well as any best practices that you may come across. It is our hope in the forthcoming periods to be able to develop also online training with regard to the human rights impact assessment guidance that we have developed. Thank you. Next slide, please. As mentioned by the chair and clearly stipulated in our company self-assess, in our strategic plan, one key element of our work is client engagement. We're very much looking at the question of demand and supply. And of course, the security providers offer a service which is requested by a growing number of clients globally in complex and other environments. As mentioned by the chair, there are already a number of sectors and clients that look to the association and the code as key references with regard to their human rights due diligence and in dealing with provisional security in the supply chain and the respect for human rights. This year, we focus in particular on one sector, that of the humanitarian agencies, the humanitarian sector. It needs to be recalled, and as we have mentioned in previous years, that in high risk and fragile environments, the range of clients are not simply limited to governments and corporate entities, but as we have seen, to a growing number of aid agencies and humanitarian actors. As such, in cooperation with GISF, we developed a couple of years ago a toolkit on procurement for humanitarian agencies. And then we have just issued our first policy as well as full report on PSC procurement practices by the humanitarian sector in a number of contexts. The full publication is available online, but I think you can see the main key findings that we have identified through this report. The first is a statement of the fact that humanitarian organizations are relying more and more on the social supply security providers. Yet it would seem that not all and not that many humanitarian organizations are equipped to make informed decisions when contracting private security companies. An area of particular concern through our work was the fact that cost and low cost was the main driver in the selection of PSPs, even though this approach could generate more risks for humanitarian organizations. Humanitarian organizations seem to have limited awareness of and make little reference to international standards governing PSPs, despite their use in many high-risk and fragile contexts. There is, of course, a risk associated for humanitarian agencies, both in terms of acceptance as well as in trust, but also a physical risk, if they use and recruit security providers that fall short of international standards. And then last but not least, in many contexts, we have noted that the personnel of private security companies and their working conditions are clearly substandard, and that a number of humanitarian agencies should be focusing and prioritizing this to ensure that personnel security providers that they're using are being given the appropriate working conditions, pay, salary, etc. The report, ladies and gentlemen, which is available online, goes into a lot more detail in terms of methodology, as well as the findings and recommendations to the aid agencies, as well as to donors and governments that may have a relationship with the humanitarian sector. This particular report is hopefully the first that we of many that we'd like to develop in the next few years with a sector-specific approach. Next slide, please. Last but not least, as part of this summary, we should recognize the important work that our civil society organizations have sort of carried out over the past 12 months, despite the COVID-19 restrictions, as well as other limitations to their activities in a number of contexts. As noted by the chair, as a multi-stakeholder organization, we rely on the support as well as commitment, not only of the private security providers who are implementing code, but also of governments as regulators and donors and civil society organizations representing affected communities or communities with an interest in the activities of private security providers in their context. We will certainly need to note the work, for instance, of AfriLaw, the New Nigeria Foundation in Nigeria, the Iraqi Al-Hamal Association in Iraq, Uslama Reforms in Kenya, and OER ARSC in the DRC, who have worked with us quite closely this year on engaging with regulators and developing the capacity of civil society organizations in country to support the association and to strengthen monitoring as well as capacity building elements of organizations in different contexts. Last but not least, with regard to civil society partnerships, we are engaging with civil society organizations in a number of contexts in East and West Africa, as well as the Middle East, to develop baseline studies as well as mapping of prior security trends in those respective contexts. Those reports would be particularly important to inform the work of the association going forward in different regions of the world to see where the association's added value lies and how we can further strengthen our relationship with our civil society organization partners in those countries, but also with the security industry, clients and regulators in those respective contexts. Next slide, please. Mr. Chair, with a sort of short summary of the annual report, which, as I mentioned at the very beginning, is available online or will be available online, hopefully by the end of the day, and we do welcome our comments. Allow me to conclude with a few positive remarks. First, despite the COVID-19 restrictions, which I think are still impacting many of us in different locations around the world, the association has been able to achieve its prioritized objectives over the reporting period. It has required a certain level of agility, but we have been able to count on the support of our board, as well as our members and affiliates in different parts of the world to make this feasible and to achieve those key objectives with the greatest impact. I would certainly like to underscore the work on our training on PSCA as one example of a great piece of work which was able to carry out virtually without any in-country presence. We have made key advances on the 2019-2023 strategic plan, as reflected in this presentation, but also in the full annual report. In particular, the work with regard to certification has been important in terms of developments and in terms of buy-in by our security companies, and noting that the majority or the largest group of prior security providers within the association are now certified, with a number having been recertified. And I would also like to note the strength of our work in client engagement, be it sector specific with humanitarian actors, but also in line with procurement tools and other initiatives we have to have a greater engagement with clients. And we're starting to see some of the results with major multinationals now requiring or revising their procurement processes to require ICoCA reference and code references as part of the procurement processes. And last but not least, Mr. Chair, we do look forward to continue working with, of course, the board and all other stakeholders, members and affiliates and observers into 2022, hopefully with less COVID-19 restrictions, but certainly with the same kind of positive results and continued growth of the association. Mr. Chair, I'll pause here. Thank you.